I thank them because it gives so much hope to people like us who work in the most underprivileged communities of the world, of the planet. Imagine an island, 2 kilometers by 2 kilometers. Most underprivileged communities in the world, the river Brahmaputra flowing at 8 to 10 knots. Little villages, a family with nothing. They don't even have a boat to cross to go to safety and security when the island with the storm starts breaking. And that happens around, not for one family, but for over 6 million people on the river Brahmaputra. And that is the community that we are working with. It's possibly amongst the most underprivileged communities of the world today. And we, when you go there, the worst thing to see is the physical suffering, because physical suffering in today's world, you can make a difference. You have to understand, make them understand that there is something between suffering and dying. There is medical intervention, and even that they are not aware of, because there's nothing. So my husband and I, and this realization that if you make a small intervention, you can make a big difference to their life. It's a question of life and death. With this realization, it's the impact is amazing, because you feel a sense of commitment where you can't walk away. And this leads you to do the impossible. So my husband had sailed a river barge from France to Bangladesh, and he wanted to convert it into a floating hospital to take it to these people, you know, move from chore areas to chore areas, community to community. But you can understand how difficult it was, because it was innovative. I applied for an innovative fund and they said, but it has never been done before, so you can't do it. All right. But I think passion is very contagious. And so we went from donor to donor, and a corporate donor decided that it would work, and we were given funds to use it and convert it into a hospital. The challenge began, I thought it was earlier, but the challenge began after we actually took the ship there. This was an area where even doctors didn't want to go without a gun. People were murdering each other for 500 taka around the area. So can you imagine one woman taking a ship there, all full of foreign doctors? They thought we are going to cut off their lungs and livers and sell it. What we needed to do was transmit what we really deeply felt and wanted to do for them. We wanted them to tell us that, yes, we need you. We need you so much that we are going to be your protectors. And on the strength of this, on the feeling that if we can make this happen, it's going to work. We are going to be needed, and they are going to be our protectors. We started working. We needed commitment not only from the people themselves, but also from our staff, because their life was at stake. Security was such a big issue at that time. But I think the truth of what you want to actually give to the people has a way of committing, which is amazing. You know, we have this team of incredible people who carry the commitment, the vision, the strength, the dedication to the communities, and the community themselves accept it. So we have a team of 150 medical doctors and nurses who are coming in every year, providing service in this area, totally surrealistic. Because they come in, they perform miraculous operations. And the people today, it's been 10 years that we've been giving this service in a community where people kill each other for 500 rupees. Not one life buoy has ever been stolen from our ship. We have no guns, we have no guards, security guards. It had a synergetic effect. You know, people, we decided that it would not only be primary healthcare which we first took, it evolved into secondary healthcare. It evolved into a whole healthcare system. Because I had to step back and reevaluate what is sustainability. You know, sustainability, somebody came and asked me, how do you make this financially sustainable? I don't. If I had a system, I would sell it to the United States government or the Swedish government. You don't. Sustainability was dependability of service for the poor, to make them aware that they have a service, to know where to access the service, to make them trust in services. And then sustainability was that they would keep getting the service even when we moved away. Because so often donors are funding us, and when the money is gone, nothing is left. So we needed to build a healthcare system which would continue even after the donors went away. And so what we did was, after the ship moved, we have satellite clinics. We have about 200-300 satellite clinics, and these clinics feed the referral center, which are the hospitals. But you needed more than that. You needed people on the ground who would become little entrepreneurs, because that is what entrepreneurship is about. The people on the ground servicing a need which the community needs and adapting themselves so that, and being able to earn an income and sustain themselves. So we created what we call Friendship Community Medics, and on the belief that no development is possible, or no intervention is possible, development intervention is possible when the person is suffering. So we started off with health first. But it grew. It grew into a whole, not only a healthcare system, but into a development system, a holistic development model. Need-based is a very interesting word, you know, because need, when we went to a community, if you go to a community like the one that we are dealing with here, and you ask them what they need, they will not tell you they need a ship with doctors. So we have to stay back and evaluate. Need comes at different stages, different needs come, and we have to be with the people to understand what the need at that particular state. Because it has to be perceived by them, not as what is perceived by us, the needs. I had a donor who came once and said they wanted to give latrines. So we went, I took him to an area which was hit by the cyclone Isla, and I said, but they don't need latrines. No, they wanted to give latrines. So we went there, and then there was this old woman. So we asked that, you know, this is a donor and they want to give you latrines. Do you need them? This woman looked at me with awestruck. Said, yes, but we have to eat first. You know? And this is need-based. And at one point they would need latrines, but not at that point. So we have to be with the community to understand that. Then, when you have sustainability, will also not come in by just giving them something. Sustainability also has to come in when you instill hope in the people. And hope, if you ask any person, you walk out and you ask anybody on the streets, what is the single element that will give you hope? And it is education. Dr. Sharma was very right. It's education. And that is what everybody wants for their children, because education is their hope for tomorrow. And to create education in these islands was impossible, because 30 years had passed. There were hardly any schools, not any functional schools. You know, there were some schools, but nothing was functional. Where would you get the teachers? How would the schools last when the islands are breaking away? So we devised a totally different model of building these schools on plinths, schools which can come down in 2.5 hours, and you can, and the schools are shifting with the community and with the islands as the school shift, you know, as the islands break. We also had to take teachers from the community. Have any of you seen a whole community where not one person can read and write stuck in an island? It's incredible, because we did not know how we would start. So one person knew how to study, had read up to class 5 or grade 8, and that is what we started collecting over these 77, 78 islands. And we would take these people, teach them, totally feed them with every day, you know, every month with the daily plans, and then they would go and basically just teach the children that. But at least they could read and write, you know. These were little children who had no hopes in their life. They were stuck in an island where they could not even cross with a boat because they did not have enough money. So this is what we brought, education. And okay, that was very good. We started the education. And then I discovered that there were so many other children on the island, you know, and it was heartbreaking because we were only catering to 30 per class. So then we started a child-to-child education. You know, each child would go out and teach in the sand another child. At least everybody in the, you know, and it's so easy for children to learn. So they just learned. And ABCD and Shoryo Shoryo was taught all over the island, and children could at least access education. So there was this woman called Morgina. Our school. There was this woman called Morgina. This is her life, her home, and she used to work with us on the ship. So when I went to see her one day in the island that she was in, I asked her, how are things going? Fine, Appa. But, you know, this man who is giving them money, you know, she was a day laborer. So she would carry baskets of earth and every day, and then at the end of 10 days or 15 days, the middleman would come and pay her. She said, you know, nobody can... I don't think I'm getting as much as I'm working. How is that? I said, aren't you keeping a calculation of how many baskets you're taking? She says, no. In that whole area, nobody knew how to read and write, and they couldn't keep any count. So the middleman could come and give them whatever money they wanted. So then this was her home. Her only possession was this. So we started adult education, and over 35 islands, we opened up adult education centers. Just functional literacy, mathematics, reading, and writing. Because whatever development you want to bring to them, how can you imagine that they will go up any economic rung if they don't even know how to calculate what they're earning or manage their cash flow? So we started adult education. Very, very simple. And along with hope, you have to give people self-respect and dignity. So what we did was we identified that the people of the rivers of Bangladesh and the waters of Bangladesh have a unique craft, and this craft was dying. It was a loss for humanity because Bangladesh has the largest fleet of riverine boats in the world. And so we started preserving these boats, documenting these boats, making small models, and exhibiting them all over the world, in the marine museums of the world, because the technology and the shapes and designs were being saved. And who was building them? They were being built by those people who were left unaddressed for years and years since independence. Development for the people at the bottom of the pyramid has to be a total package. You know, they need 3 meals a day. They need to access human right tools. They need some dependable income, because if they don't have dependable income and savings, so unless you clog the hole with the need that they have at that particular moment, you know, when you are having a headache, all of you, can you study? Can you do anything? When you have a very bad headache, what do you want? Education goes out of the window, empowerment goes out of the window, all you want is a paracetamol. So that is what you have. When you go to a community, you have to identify what is it that they need at every structure. Because 1.50, which is what the baseline for poverty is, and between 0.05 of earning of a dollar, it's the difference between life and death. With 1.25 you can live, with 0.5 you can't live. And there are as many structures in between as there are between us and the poor people, what we consider poor. So there are as many differences in the poor rate also. So we have to understand that there is no panacea for everything. You know, you have one solution, it's a brilliant solution, it suits one area, one group of people, it's not going to necessarily suit another one. And we have to be humble enough to understand that, look, when we are with them, our objective is them. It's not our project. It's not our system. It's to bring them to a certain economic bracket, to ease their suffering, to bring them hope. That has to be the objective of any, not even an entrepreneur, or for any human being. And once that strikes you, and you find a cause strong enough, you start working on that. You know, poverty is multifaceted, and need is also as multifaceted. So we started on a program because in this area it was very disaster struck. You know, this Bangladesh is one of the countries which are going to have the worst. It will be worst affected by climate change, and this area is one of the worst affected in Bangladesh. So we started. So we started a kind of a micro insurance come savings come microfinancing model, which incorporated grants, capacity building, and then we would give them loans. So it had a tremendous impact, because if you just come in with microfinance, of course, most of you now know it doesn't really work. You have to incorporate, and just microfinancing for the ultra poor, no way is it going to work, because they're going to eat it all up. So you have to incorporate a holistic package for them to work. This has been so beautifully said by Mr. Tata, that in a free enterprise, the community is not just another stakeholder in business, but is in fact the very purpose of its existence. And you know, today, when people tell me that I remember when people had, when I first started, people had told me that, Runa, you're going to sacrifice so much for being just a drop in the ocean. You know, and I sit back and I think that I want to ask the widow whose child can eat today. I want to ask the child who was burnt for 3 days and we picked the child up and brought him to the ship to be treated. I want to ask the people who have hope with their children's education. The woman who has had surgery with prolapsed uteruses, you know, for 10 years she was suffering. If that drop was an important drop or not, that drop is our responsibility. And everyone has to strive to do that. Thank you.